Well, tonight we're going to have communion, and you know, hallelujah, hallelujah. And you know, I have a bunch of different things I want to say about communion and why we have communion, what it's all about. But you know, I'm just going to minister to you on some things this Lord put in my heart to share with you tonight. And so I'm going to see if maybe I can get this little iPad to work for me. Praise the name of Jesus. Musicians, you can take a break, but be real nearby, because when we start communion, I want you to be able to flow in the Holy Ghost and sing things by the Spirit. Amen. Amen. Not out of concern, frustration, worry, or performance. Not under pressure. You can't really move under pressure. You know, you can't, how many of you understand, you can't move in God under pressure? Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. You get in His presence and you'll get right over into the rest. Praise God. You'll be so caught away in God, you won't have any self-consciousness around. Man, I'm glad I don't look as sad as some of you. And I pray in the name of Jesus, I never feel like some of you look right now. I never want to feel that way. Somebody said, can't you sympathize for me? No, I can't, because God made a way for you not to be, have to look like that, feel like that, act like that. I have no sympathy for you. None at all. All I can do is point you towards heaven and say, come on, man. Amen. Come on, step on over here in this realm of divine power and glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How somebody could be sad and upset after all this just because it didn't connect. Somebody said, what I got to do, connect? Well, you know what? Go ahead. You know, I know when I go through the whole sermon message on Friday night, the Lord laid on my heart to give to you, and we so spoke to you by the Spirit of the Lord to open up to you doors of access into the realms of glory. Just go ahead and give yourself to it. Start doing it and understand that you participate with God. I'm going to tell you right now, He's going to participate with you. Hallelujah. Hi. You start saying, oh God, lay hold on me. Lay hold on me. Lay hold on me. And He's an expectation that you lay hold on Him, because I'm going to lay hold on you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 That's a beautiful song. Jesus, my refuge. Hallelujah. Jesus, my dwelling place. Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Man, this is still your opportunity. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody wants to start flowing in the Holy Ghost and the Spirit of the Lord so thick for an altar call at the end of the meeting. Look, you need to have it in the beginning of the meeting. You don't understand. You don't understand the dynamics of the things of the Spirit and the order of the house of the Lord, but we're here to teach you. Praise God. Hallelujah. Because God, the Holy Ghost, is going to bring something. He's going to bring something. He'll sit down in the midst of His Word. I tell you, we labor in the Word of God. We obey God. Some people say, well, I don't like the way I preach. Well, you know what? If you didn't like, but the thing about it is, the presence of God moves in a place because of the way I preach. If I didn't preach like the way I preach, you wouldn't move, the presence of God wouldn't be in the house. Hallelujah. Father just comes honor and witness that I obeyed Him and did what He told me to do. That's all. Hallelujah. Secondo rabatitis frumande revi. Mumana menishtikando kantevre manist. Mevrima meg ding jin mangdaluk unina nenu nandu nani nani dulamani. Menon nonina, ha ha. Munani nona monina. Murama mane. You know why I can do this? Because I absolutely have no demonic interference at all. None. Zero. And myself is completely yielded to His self. Hallelujah. And what He gave to me, He'll give to you. And what He's done for me, He'll do for you. Hallelujah. When there's nothing in the way, joy unspeakable flows like a river. When there's nothing in the way, the joy of the Lord overwhelms you. His love takes hold of you. Your peace is like a river. Your righteousness like the mighty way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. Oh, I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Now, you can't sing this unless you're doing it. Otherwise, it's a violation. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Woo-hoo! And that's just the way it is with all of God's word. You just start speaking it and you start participating with his word. Hallelujah. Not with philosophy and ideology, not with the opinions of men, not a mixture of the word of God's word, your word, somebody else's word, but his word and his word alone. And you begin to say, he has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. And you know, we're just singing the scripture. I love songs that just are nothing other than just screaming, singing, hallelujah, screaming it to the word of God. Because if you get the word of God in your mouth and you just start participating with what he says in his word, and you just, in that participation, you're there submitting yourself, then the response of his word begins to take impact. The life and the power of his word begins to overwhelm you. So you could even be sad and you just start going, he has made me glad, he has made me glad. And just start dancing a little bit with it. Yeah, my will rejoice, for he has made me. You'll be happy real quick. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. Oh, I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Not the groceries, not the finances, not because everything is going your way, not because of all earthly interest and affection, but just him. Just him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't want to stop praising Jesus. It's the greatest thing I do. I don't want to stop praising Jesus. It makes this light come through. I don't want to stop praising Jesus. It's the river of God in me. And I won't stop praising Jesus for all eternity. Amen. Some people haven't started. Amen. And that just kind of, that won't work out good for you. Just go ahead and give yourself over to worshiping Him and loving Him and praising Him and giving thanks to Him. Hallelujah. Start just doing the simplicity of what God's Word has to say. And then you'll begin to live every day in the blessings and the outworking of His Word. I don't like anything but proofs. I am a proof-oriented person. Somebody said, was it because you were trained in the sciences? No. It's simply because I've always just been that way. I want the thing to work. And if it doesn't work, let's reinvestigate. And Father wants you to grab a hold of the things that He's promised and placed a demand upon your own self to have those things which He's made available. And you know that if I could just convince everybody tonight that you don't have to spend any day tomorrow empty, void, desolate, unhappy, or looking anything other than what someone looks like if they're a saint in heaven. Okay? And I sometimes wonder, does people know what a saint in heaven looks like? Let me just say this. It looks better than a seraphim in Isaiah chapter 6. Right? Uh-huh. Smile. Groan. Okay. I know that reality of it is that's a little bit too much for some people, but God has given to us more than they have. He's given to us something that they desire to look into. People want to see angels. Angels want to see you. People want to see what angels are doing. Angels want to look in and behold what God has made available to you, where the Almighty has made Himself in such a way that He would come and make His abode in you and me. Come on, people. Let's quit living in religion. Start living in the reality of what He's done. Because it doesn't matter what you know about God. What matters is whether or not you let that flow through you. That those things which God has declared in His Word can be witnessed in your life. If it can't be witnessed in your life, there's a disconnect between you and reality. There's a disconnect between what's going on in your life and what God has for you. And we're here, we're devoted to make sure that if there is any disconnect, we fix it. Yes. But if we start, working on your wires, you start screaming, hollering at us because we're trying to fix the wires, the disconnect, what can we do? It's not my fault your wires are messed up, broken or whatever. I'm just over here trying to fix the mess you in. Hallelujah. Praise God with divine ability, divine power. Huh? I can't help but your light bulb burn out. We here changing the thing, man. Putting in a long-lasting, eternal one. Amen. Hallelujah. It's time for an upgrade. My goodness, that 2-watt light bulb ain't helping anybody. Let's go at least to 20 water. You'll start getting the place you want more light. You want more glory. You want more of that which Father has. It's free, but listen, I'm telling you right now, God still, nonetheless, is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. He demands us to hunger and thirst and passionately pursue Him. Before I get into 2 Corinthians chapter 6, there's a couple of things I really want to point out to you, because we're getting ready to do communion tonight, and communion just helps you to handle and touch that much more closely, that sacrifice that the Lord provided for us in Himself. Because in the Old Testament and even in the millennial reign, there are going to be sacrifices that will show us what God actually did for us, how that, all those sacrifices of the Old Testament really proved to us and showed to us and demonstrated for us the penalty of sin, the consequence of it, and the mercy of God that was provided through the blood offering. And here the Lord has provided something so worthy, so glorious, so unmeasurably, unimaginable, and all the other ones, so that it goes far beyond what we can reckon or understand or logically explain, the blood of Jesus Christ. that we take and we handle and we drink it. You know, I love the old people all the time. Best thing you can do is just always have yourself some bread, eating the living bread, the bread of life, the word of life, communing with Christ Jesus, the hidden manna, because he is the hidden manna. In the Hebrew language, it's the afikumen. The afikumen is the hidden manna, which speaks of the Messiah that would come. Just always have some communion going on. When you get concerned, worried, just take another little sip of the cup. It represents that blood that washes us and cleanses us. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin, because we walk in the light as he is in the light, and his blood just continually, hallelujah, cleanses us. Now, I want you to just consider with me for 1 second what the Lord said. Peter said, how often must I forgive somebody? Must I forgive them 7 times? And what did the Lord say? Come on, give me some boldness. Come on. Spit it out. There you go. That sounds like you really believe and know what you're talking about. You were like, what was it 7 times 70? It was 7. Amen. There's some authority. Amen. Huh? And he said, so will your thank you very much. Do what? Isn't God good? Some people think we're Adam and Eve living in the garden. If you sin once, it's over. I'm going to tell you right now. God in that way, that's not what he said. Hallelujah. Father has made a way where we never have to sin at all. But praise God, if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, a means by which our sins can be washed away and forgiven. And what God is going to demand is that we participate with him. God demands you to forgive people all around you all the time, and you better get good at it. Practice makes perfect. Get good at it, because he's not going to forgive you if you don't forgive them. I mean, Father, in his mercy, his grace, said, I'll forgive you as many times as you need. Because, you know, the reality of it is, you can be literal with 7 times 70. There's no problem. That's 490, okay? 490 times in a day. Do the math. You're awake for how many hours? Let's just say that you wake for 16, you sleep for 8, okay? Something like that. I mean, come on, people. How often are you getting forgiven per hour? Hello? Are you listening to me? Yes. Huh? And my goodness, you talk about mercy abundance and mercy. Wow. I mean, God is devoted. You know, when he said to Moses, he said, I did not reveal myself to Abraham, Isaac, and to Jacob by my name Yahweh. They were only known by my name El Shaddai, or God Almighty. And then he revealed what Yahweh means. I see all these theologians playing around, diddle-dallying around, parsing out, trying to dissect and dichotomize God and his word and try to figure out what Yahweh means. I'll tell you what it means. It means merciful. It means loving kindness. It means long-suffering, full of truth and goodness, because that's what he said it meant. Hallelujah. And you're going to have to get a hold of God's bigger than you are. His love is greater than yours. He is here to perfect us. He's not waiting for you to get perfect, then he's going to save you. That is just the biggest lie Satan ever told anybody. When you get good enough, right enough, and you prove it enough, then you must be right enough. No, he takes us right where we are at, and he changes us to be like him. And if you've got a desire in your heart to love righteousness and hate iniquity, it is a proof that you have received the nature of God. If the love of God is there, and a hunger for him, and a thirsting to be right with him and do what's right, it's proof that there is a nature change. If there is within you a desire to seek God and lay hold on him and do it his way, it's proof of a nature change. It's proof enough. And then he's going to take that, and we're just like little babes, and he's going to take us, and he's going to develop us, and he's going to grow us up, and he's going to mature us. But you got to quit at some point in time acting like your silly self and start imitating God. Huh? There are some people that think that sacredness centers around them, and that they the expression of what looks like to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. People, give me a break. Come on now. Jesus is. Hallelujah. Hey, Pentecost is just the warm-up session. Look at that ecstasy. Look at that ecstasy. Praise God. Come on, man. Hallelujah. How many of you want to be in a Pentecostal meeting? Think about it. How many of you in here like to be in a Pentecostal meeting tonight? A couple of you. I'm in one, personally. I don't know why the reluctance of the hands. What was it? Did you think that was a trick question? Oh, you thought it was a trick question. Amen. I can understand that. Now I was like, what is the reluctance of that? Hallelujah. But I mean, you think about the scale of, you know, for me, I'm like, when I begin to think about that, I am still in expectation. I'm not going to lower it or limit it. I'm still in expectation to see flames of fire distill upon each person's head. Clothing, tongues of fire. Hallelujah. The lambent glow of God's presence and glory comes set upon rushing mighty wind. Feeling blessed. I have a friend of mine. He prayed for a breeze to flow through. He's not alive anymore, but prayed for a breeze to flow through the meeting because everybody was hot and a wind of God came. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was a dear friend of mine, brother Philip Smithhurst. You know, they had this huge giant meeting. And so with all of these various different people in Africa and you know, leaders and whatnot, and one of the Roman Catholic preachers wanted to get up and say his little spiel. And so, you know, reluctantly, what happened was God allowed it. And Philip just kind of said, okay, I'm going to give you, but just take 5 minutes. And so God allowed it, and he allowed it. He felt released to do it. But the guy went more than 5 minutes. He started going on and on and on. You know what happened? A wind came. They looked, and behold, a wind came. And it began to blow. And the trees began to shake just right outside of the place. It was calm and quiet inside the tent. It began to blow. It began to stir the trees all around. They watched it. Matthew Kuhnkamp was there. They watched the thing. And it went right on down the side of the tent that they were in. Went right to where the Catholic priest was. Overturned his table, his communion, his pulpit. Everything was wiped out. He was knocked back. And Matthew Kuhnkamp went right up, grabbed the microphone and said, here's why we're here. Hallelujah! The supernatural movings of God. He's right here. He's going to take control of the meeting. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jacob is going to be here. Dear friend of ours, I was listening to the preacher in Georgia last night. Or it was the other night. I was listening to it on a YouTube as he was preaching for Overland's Mission. The voice of God is there, the sound of heaven. Jacob could have had any church preach, pastor any church in the United States of America, done evangelism, whatever he would have done, it would have been ragingly successful. What he's done is he's poured out his life in Africa, on the mission field. He said, my blood will go, my body will be put into this ground. This is where I'll live out my life. If my blood leaves my body, it will go into this earth. And God has taken him. He was thrown in jail not too long ago. And after he was thrown in jail by some of the militant Congolese, the word got back to the emperor of the Congo that one of his magistrates, because actually Jacob was with one of a lawyer that the Overland's Mission took one of the bright Zambians, sent him to school and became a lawyer, but no one believed he was a lawyer because he was so young. But he was a magistrate. Word got to the emperor of the Congo that one of his magistrate was in prison. And the emperor comes and raises up Jacob's head out of the prison. And that's how it all began, that the emperor began to be drawn in to what God wants to do for the Congo because somebody was willing to go all the way with God. He's going to be here in February. I'm looking forward to him being here. Voice of heaven there. What an example. I mean, people... We're pressing in for the supernatural. We're pressing in not for the normal. I'm not interested in the normal. I'm not going to be content with the normal. And I'm going to tell you right now, somebody says, I got to submit to the normal, I'm going to start fighting. Amen. I'm going to mess everything up. Amen. I'm not submitting to the normal. Hallelujah. I'm going to be detached from the normal. They're going to call us detached. Hallelujah. I'm going to be non-compliant with the normal. Hallelujah. I'm taking a hold of that which God commands. Yes. His word is very simple. Yes. It's in very simple language. It's expressed in very simple, family, childlike very concrete, not abstract, very concrete terminology. It's unmistakable. Jesus said, Father, I thank you that you've hid it from the wise and the prudent. People think they got to have some kind of secret knowledge, got to have some kind of superior knowledge, and you've revealed it to the babes because for such seem good in your sight. So tonight I want you just to recognize how committed God is to you. God's not going to be committed to you if you harden your heart and you want to do it your own way. But you stay soft and you stay tender before the Lord to where if you fall or if you sin or if you do something wrong, you are immediately saying, oh God, forgive me. I never want to do that again. I don't care if you fall into it 490 times in a day. God said he'll forgive you. God said he'll forgive you. I know you don't understand that kind of mercy, but big deal. That don't change nothing. God's still that way. He's still merciful. He's still long-suffering. He's still tender-hearted. He's still full of goodness. He's still full of truth. And nothing's going to change his word. Not my opinion, your opinion, the king of the country's opinion, or the president, or the emperor, or anybody else. God's word's forever settled in heaven. He watches over to perform it. Hallelujah. He watches over to hasten it. Hapakura Sataya. His word is working mightily in me. It's living and it's powerful. It's spirit and it's life. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It divides asunder joint from marrow, spirit from soul. It is discerner of the thought and the intent of the heart. Hallelujah. I was born by it. It's an incorruptible seed. Hallelujah. All flesh is grass. All the glory of men as the flower of the field. The grass withers. The flower thereof fades away. But the word of God endures forever. And this is that word which we preach unto you by the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven. Hallelujah. Argue with that. You can't. Praise God. The Lord will fill your mouth with his word. You know, I'm just so blessed to be in places where there are a lot of preachers and a lot of ministers with a lot of various different ideologies and opinions and doctrinal ideas. But when God is, you allow God to form in your mouth his word, and all you're doing is weaving together as a tapestry of the Lord those things that he said by the Holy Ghost in his word. And now the Spirit of the Lord speaks to you as an oracle, and all they hear is one verse of scripture after another. They can't disagree with you. They can't disagree. Because it's God's word and it's forever settled in heaven. Some people want to kind of limit it to some time in the past, but God's not going to be limited to some time in the past. He's not going to be confined to yesterday. For today, now is the time. Today is the day of salvation. And of course, if you are very familiar with 2 Corinthians chapter 6, you know I've already been quoting 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Hallelujah. Man, I'm just telling you right now, just all I can do is contain myself. I'm trying to be sober for your sake, but I just want to run around the house and shout. Hallelujah. I just want to dance around. Basta corrimi talabake nabasta propatofinia. Ho ramandea lishifrando comania patolo pushapaya. And prophesy. Amen. And I pray that happens to you tonight, quickly. Jesus. Great miracles, great signs and wonders is what's on Father's agenda. That's what God has purposed. That's why you're here tonight. You're here tonight because you're responding to the Spirit of the Lord that wants to come on the inside of you and shape you and empower you and enlarge you so that you can begin to receive from him and move with him in the realms where your own thinking and your own ideas about yourself would not allow you to go. God wants you to begin to think of yourself in a different way so that you'll be willing to follow him where the Spirit of the Lord wants to lead you right on over into the fullness of God. Hallelujah. Right over into the life of Jesus Christ. And just go ahead and be empowered by God to be a signs and wonders and miracle worker. Amen. To live over in joy unspeakable. To live over in the fullness of God. To live over in a place where you can fulfill what God said in his word and be continually baptized in the Holy Ghost. Yes. I mean, think about it. If God's people would be so simply obedient to just simply do one verse of scripture, don't be unwise, but be wise, knowing what is the will of God. Redeem the times, for the day is evil. Don't be drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit.
Amen.
Speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart, proof of full filled with the Spirit. Huh? Proof. Hallelujah. Ooh, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, so that you may be able to admonish one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody. One way he said it to the church at Ephesus, the other way he said it to the church of the Colossia. You put them both together and you got an orchestrated event in heaven going on inside of you. And then you know what people do is they get into temptation, they get into frustration, they get into challenging circumstances, and they just sit and soak and marinate and bake in it. Instead of just stopping and saying, wait a minute, Lord, fill me right now. I want to be filled. It's how you redeem the time. This is how you rise and shine, for your light has come. This is how you begin to be yielded to the Holy Ghost. This is how you begin to move in the Spirit. This is how you begin to walk in the Spirit. This is how you put on the Lord Jesus Christ. This is how you begin to function in all that dimension of heaven that has been made available to us. Your will.
Amen.
You forget. What am I doing? Where am I at? Who am I? What do I look like? Many people go and read the word and say, as a man beholding his image in a natural image in a glass. And straightway he leaves from beholding himself in the mirror and forgets what manner of man he is. It's time in the name of Jesus to begin to walk in the wisdom and the insight and the knowledge of the Lord, so such a state will not infect you.
Amen.
Anymore.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Just look here in this verse of scripture. I'm going to just read to you a little bit, okay? Hallelujah. We then as workers together with him. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That's what some of you did today. I mean, I was so blessed to see so many people brought in to so many children brought into the children's ministry, because people or some folks in this place that said, I'm going to be a worker together with the Lord Jesus Christ. And wherever there is an opportunity to go get some souls, I don't care how big of a mess they are. I don't care how much damage control it is. We're going to go get them, because we got an anoint to break that old yoke off of them, to change them, to get them. I mean, we let down the net. We caught some fish. It's time to go clean them up. They said, no, that's stinky business. Let somebody else clean the fish. I just want to come and eat them. But that isn't the way that it works. Hallelujah. The Lord's not only given us the ability to be with him, to make. He says, I'll take you and make, this is God's people, I'll take you and I'll make you fishers of men. Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful that we can be workers together with him? See, when we start obeying God, we discover the blessing. When we start obeying God, we are now seeking him according to due process, the correct order. When we start obeying God, we are really diligently seeking him. All these other things isn't really seeking him according to his due order and process. It's not real heartfelt, I want to know you, God. I want to lay hold on what you have for me. That's only discovered in obedience. And I'm so blessed to see so many children come, and we're going to help Sandy and James go ahead and be able to rent a van on Saturdays. And I pray that every one of you do it, because you can reproduce what they're doing. They just went and they started moving in faith. They just got a little wind of the Spirit. Just a little wind. It's just a little baby breeze. Huh? It ain't the full-on, you know, tempest blast that's yet to come. It was a baby breeze, and they responded to the baby breeze of the Spirit, and God breathed faith into them. They went laid hold on a building. You had 13 people there the other night, right? Thursday night. Praise God. And you ministered on, what'd you minister on? Huh? It was powerful, whatever it was. Hey, praise God. You minister on the new creation. Come on now. Hey, man, 13 people in just a few weeks, 16 children. Come on. If you just start doing that, if you just start quick, don't delay. Just sit around. I'm just waiting for something to happen. What? It's already happened.
Amen.
It's already happened.
Yep.
You start doing this and faith will grow and develop on the inside of you as you be, his purpose becomes your purpose and you become laborers together, not sitting around just hypothesizing and dry labbing it. Huh? Just still in theory class. You now living in Him and moving in Him, and His desire is your desire and His will is your will, and your movements are His movements. And now all of a sudden you begin to have a burden for the lost, even for those who are just disgustingly lost. Even for the aggravating lost, even for the uncaring, don't want to listen to you or see you get out of my face lost. You get a compassion for every kind. Ooh, that's where prayer really begins, because your prayer isn't about you and how God's going to help you and get these things through for you and all these other things about you, me. It sounds like a channel that's not coming in, right? It becomes about the lost. It becomes about laying down our life and loving, letting God love through us and loving a world around us. But most importantly, you can't even begin to love the world around you until you begin first and foremost to love the brethren with the same love wherewith He loved us. You can't have another kind of love. God demands that we love one another just like He showed us how to love. He defined love for us. If Christ loved us so much that He laid down His life for us, we ought also to lay down our life for the brethren. Oh my goodness, wouldn't church be a revival center if that was happening? If everybody would just let the Spirit of the Lord come begin to move on them. And yeah, you know, that's going to be a consecration commitment, because people around you are going to do things you don't like. I'm going to do a lot of things you don't like. And if you don't know that yet, hang around. Because I'm going to tell you exactly those things that are your problem. And nobody likes that. I'm going to show you your sin as God has ordained and commanded me to do it. And better than that, I'm going to show you how to get out of it. Hallelujah. I'm going to show you how to walk with God, because that's my job. Nobody gets all happy with the dentist that's got to go in there and drill that cavity out of there. You want to get in that chair and say, yeah, smile. Oh, that looks really good. You're fine. You're good to go. Now you feel good about that dentist. But as soon as he grabs the drill and he goes on you. Hey, people, you know it's a tough job. Somebody's got to do it. And you have to be called to do this job. You can't select yourself. There is no way that you can be a pastor longer than 2 years unless God ordained you, called you, because that's the only way you're going to have the grace to do it. Because nobody likes you to tell them what their problem is. It hurts. Huh? It's condescending. People get defensive about it. They want to tell you, you feel uncomfortable with it. You feel rejected and unwanted when somebody starts telling you the truth about what you need. But this is the way it is. And you have to get a hold of Jesus enough to where you can walk in brokenness and humility and say, oh, God, shine the floodlight of heaven upon my soul, for I want to be fashioned and shaped by you. I want to be conformed to your word and to your image. I want to obey you in every area of my life. Hallelujah. 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 I probably called out just about everybody in this place one time or other. And God does that. You know, people read about it. If you're a son, God will correct you. But then you start getting corrected and you're going, what's going on now? This ain't the love of God. Well, what do you think correction looks like? Hello. Give me a break. Huh? What did you, the Lord says in Hebrews chapter 12, in the context of being disobedient, He will flog you. He didn't just say, I'll chasten you. He said, I'll flog you. Huh? Yeah. And people think that's going to be like a private session at home. the way it works, you need to read the Bible a little bit more and understand how the program goes. Because what happens is we want to have church out of churchanity. We want to have a concept of God that's based upon religious ideology. But God's got a very practical application that He shows us very clearly in His Word. And isn't He good? Isn't He tender? Isn't He merciful? Hallelujah. Isn't He long-suffering? Because the bottom line of it is, listen, it's crazy for anybody to say, you know, I just feel like giving up. My goodness, if anybody ought to give up around here, it's God. And He ain't giving up. What are you talking about? You're going to just give up. Give me a break. All you're doing is just upset with yourself. Huh? And just go ahead and be, you know, just understand Don't look to yourself to see to bring the change. Don't look to yourself to see the things of God established within you. Look unto Him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Look unto the rock from which you were hewn. That rock that you are carved out of. Christ Jesus, I carved right out of Him. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It is amazing how good God is to us. And you know what the thing about it is? I'm going to tell you right now, the Lord, I promise you, the Lord is a whole lot more patient with you than I am. He is. And I mean, think about how patient I am with you. No, I am. Just you get in the ministry and you start dealing with a bunch of people and their issues and let's see how well you do. Let's see how well you do. You know, it's really hard to really understand what's going on when you've never really gotten into the nitty-gritty, the details of it, and the conflict of it, and the issues associated with it. Come on now. People, I'm honestly, I've pastored hundreds and hundreds of people over the years. I've seen thousands of people come and go. I've sat in the counseling room with so many people. I've watched God do great miracles in mass evangelism and in churches, in this place, in this ministry. I've been here for 35 years. I was thinking today, how many years have I been baptizing out there at that beach and no one asked me for a permit? And I've known that it's been since 1992. I was talking to the guy today. I was talking to one of a permit from me. I'm thinking, he probably wasn't even born when I started baptizing people here. I wasn't even born yet. He's trying to tell me whatever it is he's telling me. Give me a break. First, I thought it was 35 years, but I remembered, no. You know, we used to, when we were over there in the Point Loma area, we'd just go down to Ocean Beach or go down to Point Loma Nazarene University and baptize down there. It wasn't until we actually moved into Claremont Mesa in 1992 that we started baptizing Torrey Pines. But, you know, what I've discovered over and again with God, there are some people who will just get offended and they're gone, because that's one of the primary ways is Satan shuts people down and stops them from moving forward. A spirit of offense is one of the primary ways that Satan will grab a hold of you. He will shut you down. He will turn you away from the things of God. He will separate you from what God ordained for you to have. And if you just get an understanding of that, just a simple knowledge of that, now you can be a person that is sober and vigilant and aware of your enemy that goes about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. True. You won't be ignorant of Satan's devices and he won't allow offense.
Amen.
And yet it's easy not to allow offense when you love his word. Because if you love his word, what?
Nothing offends.
Nothing shall offend you. Come on, right? Perfect peace have they. Huh? And? That pretty well takes care of that old spirit of offense. Satan's primary strategy. You're done. You're good. Satan's primary thing he's going to do to try to take you out. Can't work on you. Because you're just delighting in the ways of God and His Word. I mean, one of the most important things for you to understand is how to be clothed with humility. How to walk in love and be clothed with humility. It is a defense. It is the weaponry. It is the armor of God. See, if you hear me teach on the armor of God, I'm not going to do it tonight. I don't talk about all these other things mean people talk about. That's fine. That's what God given them to do. I talk about the nature of God. Fundamental nature of God is lowliness, His meekness, His humility, His love. That's His armor. That's an impenetrable realm of divine glory. That's His righteousness. What a breastplate. That's what salvation brought to me in the divine nature. His character. What a helmet. His powerful word that created the universe and placed everything in its order. That's some serious shoes to have on. The preparation of the gospel of peace, where I can say to the wind and the wave and the storm, obey me now. Peace. Where I can go to a person that is tormented and vexed and afflicted, and they really want to be set free. They're not looking just for me to agree with them or to justify them. They want whatever it takes, and say, my peace I give to you. As He gave me peace, I give you the same peace He gave to me. And immediately the glory of God touches them. That is the most wonderful thing. And Father's empowered every one of us to be able to be those ministers of peace and those ministers of righteousness. Where there is peace, there is righteousness. Where there is no peace, there is no righteousness. That's why the Lord said, if you would have just hearkened to me, if you would have just obeyed me, then your peace would have been like a river. And it's not one that's going to dry out. I mean, it's one that's continually flowing. It's like the Mississippi is bigger. Nobody's worried about the thing drying out. They worried about it overflowing its banks, but drying out, no. Your peace shall be like a river, and your righteousness like the waves of the sea, and nothing stopping those waves, and nothing going to divert them, redirect them. Try to redirect a wave, would ya? Huh? You can't even create men, and the technology cannot even create devices to capture its energy. If there could be a device created in our advanced technology to be able to place it out there in the ocean to get the energy, to harvest the energy of the waves, it would power every city in the world. But nothing can stop those waves. If you're in it, you're ruined. Nothing can divert it. Nothing can slow it down. It'll break into pieces anything that tries to stand in its way. That's the way that God gives to us and establishes within us as laborers, as co-laborers together, as fellow laborers in this one purpose. This is where heirship is meaningful. Otherwise, it's just like, well, I'm an heir of God and co-heir with Jesus. I don't even know what that means, but it sounds good. Well, when you begin to do what he does, walk with him in his ministry, give yourself to what's going on in the realms of heaven. Hallelujah. Then all of a sudden, the heirship becomes valuable because you begin to see supernatural supply to you. I promise you, I was like many people. I was afraid at one time in my life to let go. I thought that God needed me to provide for myself. He needed me to help myself, take care of myself. But when I fully let go, I found out that he was a far better perfecter than I could be. He was a far better provider than I was ever. He is a far better at everything. And he wants to be there. He wants to prove himself. You've got to give him some room. Hallelujah. You've got to start moving with him. Just move with him. Just start moving with him. Amen. For when we then are workers together with him, we beseech you also that you receive not the grace of God in vain. Because he's saying, look, you're supposed to be workers as well. God has poured this anointing out on you. To every man is given a measure of faith. Everybody gets to function in what they get to do based upon the grace of God that was given to them. That's what Paul said in Romans chapter 12. An abundance of grace was given to the Apostle Paul. He said, I am what I am by the grace of God. He said, well, everything I've done is something that was gifted to me. God gave it to me, and he didn't bestow it upon me in vain. I labored more than all the rest of them with the grace that was given. Now, you know, Paul is a very unique situation. I don't want to scare anybody or anything, but he had an abundance of grace, so much so that God wanted to make sure he didn't get carried away and get all puffed up, so he allowed an angel of darkness to continually buffet him. He said, Lord, this angel is constantly harassing me and buffeting me. Somebody looked around and said, my goodness, he must be demonized. No, God allowed an angel of darkness. That's angel of darkness is far more powerful and far more worse in a situation of dealing with having to deal with it than some little demon. And of course, it wasn't something on him. It was something that was there always resisting him, okay, standing up against him, creating all kinds of problems, always running interference. But still, look at the abundance of grace, the revelation, the knowledge of God, the display of the power of God. I tell you right now, I'll go with that any day. Yeah. Hallelujah. 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 But you know what I've discovered in God is that people who have not learned how to walk in obedience to God and submit themselves to him and to his ways, who've never learned how to stop making spiritual violations, when you step into a greater realm of the anointing, you continue to make spiritual violations, there is consequences and there's fallout. People die around you, loved ones. People get diseased. It's all kinds of issues begin to happen. And that's true. And the Bible says it. And that's why people take communion and they don't examine themselves and they take it and just basically disrespectful, unaware, not, you know, being mindful of the sacred thing that it is. He said they eat and drink damnation. And for this cause, many are sick and die over communion, spiritual violation over something that's sacred. Huh? I'm not going to go on with that. I'm not going to go on with that tonight. Just a warning. God's things are holy. It's always holy. His realm is sacred. Father wants to prepare us into every good work in Him, where we're not walking around creating spiritual violations, but we understand the laws of the Spirit of life which are in Christ Jesus, which has made us free from the law of sin and death. Praise God. So that the enemy can't be able to put anything on us. But come on, people, it's just time for us to grab a hold of these things of the Spirit. I mean, I'm telling you right now, that one of the most important things, dear people, for you to do in walking with God and being prepared for God, by God, and moving with God, is just shut up. Quit spitting your own opinion, because it's going to get you in trouble. It's going to get you in trouble. The things that people say with their mouth, they defile themselves with their words. That's why you just get to keep your words over there. Keep them loving. Keep them blessing. Bless and curse not, so that you may inherit a blessing. Amen?
Amen.
That's what Father wants us to do. I mean, even Isaiah said, oh no, I live in the midst of unclean people with unclean lips. And he said, you know, immediately he's basically having to deal with the wrong things, the wrong attitudes he had. And praise God, a seraphim was able to take tongues, grab a coal from off of the altar, because it's too holy for the seraphim to touch. Come fly, touch his lips and say, your iniquity is taken from you, your sin is purged. Isn't that beautiful?
Yes.
Now we got something better than the coals. We got the blood of Jesus. Praise God. The power, the blood of Jesus Christ to remove away sin and iniquity and every work and activity of the demonic. Wow. To be able to see it, handle it, understand it. Satan can never put condemnation or shame or offense or guilt or any of those other things that causes you to feel separated from the Lord when your trust is in the blood of Jesus Christ. When you understand, this is the new covenant in my blood, which is given to you so that your sins will be erased, blotted out, removed, remitted, remembered no more. Hallelujah. This is amazing. Praise God for the blood. Can anybody say that here? Can you just say amen?
Amen.
Can you just say, anybody say, praise God for the blood?
Thank
you. I mean, you need to get that in your vocabulary. You need to get that in a place where you can access that. That isn't a hard phrase to learn.
Praise God for the blood.
Huh? I can give you some hard phrases. I promise you, I can give you some hard phrases. Huh? But I'm not going to do it. Ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny. Isn't that the way it goes? What on earth did that even mean? Jesus. How many of you knew what that meant? A few of you did. A couple of you. It's true. Some ways. But the blood of Jesus Christ is absolutely certain. Much easier phrase. You can begin to grasp that. You may not understand ontogeny, recapitulate phylogeny. And that is not some made up word. That is a theoretical concept in science, in reproductive science, especially as it relates to embryology and the development of the fetus. Are you impressed or depressed? We'll move aside for that. But in many respects, when we begin to talk about the blood of Jesus Christ, it may be as elusive to you. The words are more understandable. You're going to taste some tonight. That's why he wants us to handle it. That's why he wants us to drink it. He wants us to feast on it, feed on it, get it on us. Have to wipe some of it off. Taste it. Because it's so important. Before that sacrificial system was always going on, and we saw that impact of it, and it was more real to us, and we could handle it. Oh, my, 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 my. Now, every time we do, we show his death till he comes. So we're not only talking about his death. We're not only talking about the slaughter and the sacrifice. You know, when John looked up in heaven, he saw the lamb presented, Christ Jesus presented as a lamb that was slain. Isn't it amazing? That's not even an allegory that God's going to actually display that. But we show him slain, the lamb slain, until he comes. So it's not only about his death, but it's also about his appearing. So in the communion, there's not only an interaction with the sacrifice that was made for us at Calvary, but there's an interaction with the power of the resurrection. Hallelujah. Within the framework of the resurrection, we in expectation of his return. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Frosha, even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Somebody says it's shaping up like the tribulation. Praise God. There's not a reason to get all upset and concerned. Even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. If it's shaping up to look like the tribulation, then that means he's coming. Hallelujah. 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 It's like one preacher said, let's get on with it. Bring it. This recently responded on a Facebook post that I sent out. It's a guy I grew up with, Tim Allen. Hallelujah. Praise God. We were kids. He was Red Cloud and I was Crazy Horse. That's just where we, you know, with the other kids, right? Now we preachers. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Tim said the other night, said, ask me where the Ark of the Covenant is. I know where it is because I read in the Bible. It's in heaven. It's caught up. The Lord took it. It belongs to him. I'll show that to you sometime if you'd like to see. Yeah. Hallelujah. Not buried in Ethiopia. Hallelujah. Father knows how to take care of his stuff. He don't just lay keep his sacred stuff and just laying all around. Just laying around somewhere out there. Somebody's got it. I don't know what last happened to it. He's got his stuff. His sacred things, he's got his stuff. Give me a break. People want to try to normalize God. You can't. He's supernatural. The relationship with him is, wow, glorious. It's glorious. I'm in expectation that right now that James, there in Quebec City, where the population is 95% no religious affiliation, so you can say they're agnostic or they're atheists, is having signs and wonders and miracles and just being displayed. Amen. And that populace of people that are standing there looking so that God could turn their hearts back to them. I mean, I'm telling you, I really like the sound of that. I'd love to be there tonight. I'm telling you right, I come alive in those things.
Yes.
I do. Right. I mean, I love pastoring because the Lord has given me a grace to do it. I love doing his will. He's given me a grace to do it. Yes. For me, it isn't about the number of people. It's about you. It's the people that the Father has brought here. You came here because Father brought you. You think you might have come here on your own volition. I promise you, God is bigger than that. I promise you, God is bigger than that. You here under our divine mandate. Try to wiggle out. Hallelujah. Because you're going to miss out. God won't leave you out, but you can certainly miss out. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Still, it doesn't keep me from wishing I was there. I love being in that. I love being, I do well standing in front of those crowds of violent men. I do well standing in front of those people who don't believe it's going to happen. I do well in front of the masses. I have no problem standing in front, you know, in mass evangelism crusade. I have no problem. I feel comfortable. You never see me stress out?
Never.
I feel comfortable. I'm just like at home. This is it. This is what I'm here for. It's not a showmanship thing either. I'm just caught away in the glory. I'm just living out my divine destiny. I was born for such a time as this. Hey, listen, right now, God shaped me to deal with these kinds of things. Somebody telling me I got to get a permit to baptize. I come out of that water. I saw what was going on. I felt it in the spirit. I felt the thing in the spirit. As soon as a guy drove up in his little old buggy wagon. I I felt it. You're going to touch the things of God with that little old fleshly hand of yours. Ain't going to happen. So let you know right now, you're not in charge around here. That's basically what I told him. I said, listen, I want you to understand right now, you're not in charge around here. This is my beach. I was baptizing people here before you were born. I was wondering, is this good communication? Oh, it's not my fault, no. It's good communication. I will not understand. Well, I'm calling the deputy. Call the dep. I'm calling heaven. You call your whatever, I'm going to call my God. Come on, people. Father made us the head, not the tail. Hallelujah. He's put us in charge, not discharge. We're making disciples out of nations. They're not making disciples out of us. We command what's going to go down in his name.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
They made a law. You can't baptize people out in the water. It's time for people to go to prison then. It's time to fight it in the judicial system. If they can't hear there, well, they will hear, because God will do signs and wonders. God will do signs and wonders for me. He will. Listen, people don't understand passion. I tell you right now, you get into the fight, you're going to understand yourself some passion. You understand yourself some passion. I promise you. The Lord always produces passion. You know, when they arrested me in Egypt, in Alexandria, Egypt, and you know, they had all the guns flashing around. They were going to take me out into the desert. You know, I proclaimed to them, you guys have no idea what you're messing with. My God will do signs and wonders and exploits that is going to blow your mind. We're looking at each other. And he did. The word of life, the word of authority, the movings of God in our life, the faith that he has given to us to command and it happens. Huh? To strike terror and the fear in the hearts of men. I promise you, that big old lifeguard, he was trembling, was shaking all over. He was manifesting. I wish I'd have had a camera. I could have just did a YouTube. This is what happens when you talk to a lifeguard under the anointing. I'm not kidding you. I was starting to feel sorry for him. Our God is an awesome God.
Yes.
It's the police coming out to the crusade we had out there on the Naval Training Center. People complained. Police came to try to tell us to turn it down, and Geneva got him. You do not know what you're messing with. I would be very careful if I were you. Come on. There's some authority going down over here. Because when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon you, you start breathing yourself some fire. But I thought you guys were supposed to be a bunch of passive non-resistors or whatever. No! Fire God! The authority of heaven! The signs and wonders and great exploits of a mighty God! To subdue nations, to work righteousness. Watch when I quench the violence of fire. Watch when I escape the edge of the sword, when I stop the mouths of lions. Hallelujah. People, I'm going to tell you right now, this isn't any place for the weak and the timid. This is the place for the strong and the mighty. The valiant and the ferocious. Hallelujah. And God gives us such boldness, such confidence.
Amen.
One time, you know, we were hearing a lot of our friends from China talk about being tortured in prison. And she said, I just don't know if I go through that kind of torture. I said, baby, don't worry about it. Don't even think about it. Because anytime you ever get in that place, Father will give you the boldness, the grace, and the divine ability. It'll be no problem. Don't even go there. It belongs to another sphere. You know, people, it's just understanding that there are the dimensions of God that we can encounter. Don't make tomorrow about anything else than encounters with the dimensions of God. It's not levels. It's not mysticism. It's the mystery of the fellowship. It's the dimensions of God, the height to which there is no top, the breadth to which there is no limit, the depth to which there is no bottom, the length to which there is no end. Come on. It's true. The dimensions of all of His fullness, all found there in this participating, our participating with the multifaceted dimensions of His love. His love of intimacy, affection for friends. His love for a lost and dying world who hates Him and curses Him. All the various different dimensions of His compassion. You know, one of the things that I'm earnest about, you know, in my life right now, probably maybe 10, 12 times a year, I will come in, I'll step into a realm of that compassions of God, and I'll begin to sob, and it's always associated with miracles. I want it to be all the time. I don't want it just to be a few times. I don't want it just to be once or twice here in the meeting in the year, and then a couple, and then other times it's out there when I'm in other places. I want that to be all the time. But there is a pursuit to have that. I've tasted it. It's beautiful. I'm going to tell you right now, when that compassion starts flowing, the miracles just happen. That nothing stops the miracles.
Amen.
I want to taste that. I want to live in that. I've tasted it. I want to live in it. Listen, there's things that God has touched you with. You ought to be pursuing them. Don't act like somehow that it wasn't an invitation from heaven for you to step in and to explore the unlimited dimensions of that joy that you touched and tasted of, that love that you touched and tasted of, that gift of faith that you touched and tasted of. Come on, man. It's supposed to build your confidence. Amen.
Amen.
God wants us to have confidence around Him. He wants us to have boldness around Him. Father doesn't go with timidity. Huh? Humility and timidity have nothing to do with each other. Timidity is a product of fear. Humility is a product of divine love. God's not interested in timidity. He makes us bold as lions. And if you've ever been around a lion, that's some serious, bold stuff. That's scary stuff. That's scary business. I'm there right now. when that lion lets out a bellow. We were across the street from the lions, Ann and I. We were across the street, and they were in secluded, isolated buildings, and we were in a hotel with all kinds of insulation and steel all night long. Boom. Boom. Huh? Oh no. Boom. And they were purring. They were just purring. Boom. When they roar, who can match that? God's made us bold like lions. He's given us the grace to be this, to do this. Hallelujah. Just in imitating Jesus in the way that He presented Himself in the midst of all the conflict. Hallelujah. Watching the authority that worked and functioned in His life. The Lord says, for He has said, and is He talking about us not allowing this grace of God to be in vain in our life, helping us to grab a hold of something. He said, I have heard you in a time that is accepted, and in the day of salvation have I secured thee. He's saying, listen, if I've touched you, believe it. I have heard you. Don't be diddle-dallying around with this, thinking somehow you've been crying out to God and He's just got deaf ears. He's not listening to you. Everybody, God loves everybody, but you. No, He's saying, wait a minute, this is for you. This is extended unto you. This is the acceptable time. This is the day. Right now is the acceptable time. Right now, behold, now is the day and the time of salvation. You're right in the big middle of it. You're right in the big midst of it. Go ahead and shout. Go ahead and rejoice. Go ahead and lay hold on all that God has given to us and set as ours in the midst of this salvation that He's brought. Don't let anybody lie to intimidate you, make you feel like you somehow less or left out. That's what Paul's saying. Give no offense in anything, so that the ministry be not blamed. But in all things, approving yourself as the ministers of God, in much patience, in affliction, in necessity, in distresses. I want you to get this in perspective so you quit whining. Huh? You quit whining in the name of Jesus. Because things aren't soft enough and cushy enough for you. You listen to me. In the name of Jesus. If there's anything hard for people to grab a hold of in America, is anything about necessities and distresses and stripes and imprisonments, in tumults, in labors, in watching, in fasting. And I, you know, if I was saying this in China right now, everybody would be going, it would be almost an ear-piercing sound. They would be going, amen! Everybody at the same time, amen! 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 Because they go through this. They go through this. Hello. They live under the threat of this every day. And it's radical. And the devotion to it. And the consecration to it. People, if we'll just start looking at this dimension of what Paul's talking about in terms of some of the fallout that takes place because we're living out the glory of salvation, we're going to quit whining about whatever little thing it is that's bothering us. Huh? Yeah.
True.
I don't even want to talk about it. It's so trivial compared to these things. Most of the things that folks get upset about and are all, you know, out of sorts about, it's trivial compared to this. But here's how we're supposed to see, and he's talking about no complaining in this. No complaining. Great confidence in this. Not feeling left out. Great boldness. Great certainty. Being encouraged about it. And later on he'll say, I'm boasting this. Let me just tell you, I'm going to boast. I'm going to tell you. You guys brag about what all you did with the exploits of God. Let me tell you, I'm going to brag about all the things I went through and the conflict and the sufferings and all that I had to endure for the name of Jesus. I'm going to boast about those things. And here's how he's telling us to behave ourselves, that the ministry be not blamed, that we're constantly shining as lights unto a lost and dark world. They can't understand their happiness when everybody else would be distressed and all upset. See, this is what changed John Wesley's life. John Wesley belonged to the Holy Club at Oxford. He had some things going on in his life, some stirrings of God. But when he's coming over on a ship, you know, to America, and they were basically in a storm and everybody was fearing for their life and there was throw up everywhere. And I mean, it was just a stinking mess. On top of it being looking like that they were going to sink to the bottom and drown. He opens up the hatch because he's down in the belly of the boat. And he opens up the hatch to get some fresh air. And he sees these guys sitting out on the deck worshiping the Lord, all happy. And their faces all lit up. And he's like, what on earth is going on? He couldn't imagine. All the Anglicans, all the preachers, all the ministers were fearing for their life, throwing up down in the mess in the bottom of the boat. And here are these guys right here worshiping, praising God with big old smiles on their face. It changed his life. The encounter with the Moravians changed his life. These people were moving in the Holy Ghost. These people were filled with the Spirit. They weren't overwhelmed by circumstances. They were in charge of the circumstances. Their life was completely under divine control. They had nothing to concern themselves about. And here's the Lord. Here's how he's telling us to conduct our life now that we received this grace. Now that we are those who are walking along as the ministers, workers together with the Lord Jesus. He says, live your life by pureness, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost. Yeah. By love unfeigned, by the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on your right hand, and by the armor of righteousness on your left hand. I mean, you come on, you tell me that this isn't something extraordinary, supernatural, heavenly, divine. This is the witness the Father's empowered you and I to be. And I hope you grab a hold of this and look like this tomorrow when everybody's concerned that the tribulation's about to take place, that Hillary's going to blow everything up, and the unstable guy is going to make it worse, or whatever, you know. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Holy, what a mess.
Oh my.
What a fine mess you got us into this time, Ollie. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, it wasn't Ollie's fault. It was the church's.
Yes.
We were sleeping in the light, slipping in the light too. And we chose as a group a progressive liberal agenda, unwillingness to go all the way with God. And while we were sleeping and while we were making compromises, Satan was able to move in and take over. And here we are. But I'll tell you right now, Father's going in His mercy and in His goodness. He's going to do great exploits in people like you and me. That's why He's talking to us about tonight about the disposition He expects us to have. The things He wants to train us up in. So we can handle the dimensions of His power and of His glory that we will just awaken to, that we'll wake up in the morning and all of a sudden everything around us will be supercharged with the glory of God. And we look at somebody and they fall out under the power. We sneeze and the devils run and flee in terror. I mean, just everything like you read about with Charles Finney and all these other folks where they just went in to get themselves some milk for breakfast and people are, there's a Holy Ghost revival in the church. I mean, in the store. Like something that would go on in a church because the presence of God was so overwhelming, the conviction of the Holy Ghost so present in their life, just because God put His weighty glory, He set down His presence upon them in a sovereign grace, and they are prepared to move with Him. So the ministry be not blamed, so that they would be, you know, witnesses of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ and not something out of place. Accurate witnesses of who He is. He says to us then that by honor and by dishonor, by evil report and good report, as deceivers and yet true. People are going to have all kinds of things to say about us. But we're not worried about it. As unknown yet well known. Doesn't matter. In other words, He said, don't matter what people say. Don't matter what's going on. Don't matter. We're going to be so into it. It's going to be God. The power of God is going to be so big, so radically revealed in our life. People are going to look at us. And they don't know whether we're coming or going. They know whether we're right or whether we're wrong. They're going to see the blessing of God and say they must be selling drugs or whatever. All kinds of crazy things. It's true. It's true. As unknown, yet well known. As dying, behold we live. As chastened, yet not killed. As sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. When we should have been dead, we alive and kicking. When we should be all sad and upset, we happy and singing. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Those women there in China, they got all beat up, tooth knocked out, broken nose, bleeding, and all they are singing away with big smiles on their face. And the guards and the people around them can't even believe it because they can't bring them to a place of sadness. They just so happy. The harder they get beat, the happier they are. Jesus. What are you going to do with people like that? You got to release them. As poor yet making many rich, as having nothing yet possessing all things. O Corinthians, our mouth is open unto you, our heart is enlarged. You are not straightening us, we are straightening in your own bowels. Now for recompense in the same, I speak as unto my children, be ye also enlarged. And then of course, Paul goes on then to begin to minister about how it's impossible for us to have anything to do with the world, anything to do with sin, anything to do with the demonic. Lays it out there. We the temples of the Holy Ghost. Just who we are. We God's people. And helps us to understand how separate we've got to be in this charge that we have as workers together with the Lord Jesus Christ, as having received this wonderful salvation in all of its fullness. Because when we talk about salvation, many times we try to interpret through culture salvation. Really, in the Bible, is talking about living under the reign of Almighty God in the Messianic age. Living in the place where the showers of blessings are falling, the rivers of God's glory are pouring out of us, where the overwhelming presence of God has raptured us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So I want people to come over and help me quickly with, Janine, come help Kate and help with the communion and put things together. And thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You know, it is just so wonderful just to think about the reality that we can walk in such a realm of pureness. Such a realm of the knowledge of God and such righteousness. To walk in such a union with God, such an authority in God that we command and it happens. Huh? We speak and it comes to pass. Hallelujah. The Father is so in our midst that He comes alongside of us and He confirms what we're saying with signs and wonders.
Amen.
Could you believe that God would confirm what you speak on in His stead with miracles and signs and wonders? I promise you He will, because that's what salvation is all about. Don't let the grace of God be bestowed on you in vain. Don't let it be that here God said all these things and I've done all these things and you're waiting yet for another day for these things to come and you don't believe it should happen somehow. You've got to earn it somehow. You've got to get to a place where it can, you know, where you're worthy of it. I mean, yeah, listen, we're supposed to walk worthy of vocation wherewith we are called, with all lowliness and meekness. Key words.
Yes.
You hear me?
Yes.
People misunderstand what it means to walk worthy of the vocation wherewith we are called, the vocation of representing God Almighty.
Amen.
That's in lowliness and meekness.
Yes.
Oh, but just to grab a hold of this beautiful, wonderful empowerment that we've received, not being worthy of it, not being deserving of it, have received it as a gift. Listen to me tonight. I received the gift of righteousness so that I could learn righteousness. That's what the Bible teaches us. That's what salvation is all about. I receive the gift of holiness so that I could be trained up and learn and grow and mature in holiness. I'm going to tell you right now, there's going to be no arm of flesh involved in this. It's going to be me looking unto the living God saying, Father, I thank you that I'm not a self-made man. I'm a God-made man. I'm not looking to human discipline, but divine surrender. I mean, listen, discipline is good and there's place for discipline, but surrender is a higher state, is far above discipline. Surrender is a place of giving yourself completely over to the reign and the rule and the dominion of the Holy Ghost. And when God begins to talk to you about something, point something in your life, you don't get all consumed of yourself and look into yourself and all, you know, overwhelmed with this situation. You immediately turn to God and say, yes, Lord, I don't want that in my life. I want what you have for my life. Come fill me now. Come heal me now. Because listen, it's not just saying, Lord, take your blood and cleanse me. It's also saying, Holy Spirit, now strengthen me. On the understanding that we bow our knee before the Father, of whom every family in heaven and earth is named. And in bowing our knee, we're coming to Him and we're looking to Him to strengthen us with the Spirit, the Holy Ghost, in our inner being, so that we might be able to do all these things and have all these things and encounter all these things.
Amen.
We bow our knee to Him and we look into Him, the one who has promised, the one who's also able to do it, who's going to do it. And we say, oh Lord, I thank you that you're the one who's rooting me and grounding me and settling me in love.
Amen.
That you're the one who's established me. That you're the one who perfects me. Holy Spirit, I yield to your direction. I yield to your encouragement. I yield to your building up. I yield to your correction. I yield to your reproofs. I yield to your rebukes.
Amen.
Father's looking for people just so rely upon Him in such a way. Tonight, when we partake of communion, understand we're partaking of the sacrifice. This is the lamb slain. This is the blood poured out. This is that which was first symbolized by Israel taking the hyssop, dipping it in the blood of the lamb, and putting it upon their doorposts and upon their lintels, so that when the death angel passed through Israel, it would not come and visit them, because the death could not trespass the line set by the blood, the house marked by it. That the blood of Jesus Christ, which that only typified, has now been applied to our lives, applied to our heart, applied to our spirit. I'm marked with the blood. If you looked at me through the realms of the spirit, you would see the blood of Jesus Christ in me. In India, in Nepal, different parts of Asia, I see people marked with the blood of the devil right there in their forehead. In Hinduism, just marked with the demonic. Huh? Marked by the sign of iniquity and the stronghold of hell. You can see me in the spirit. I got the blood on me. You have the blood on you. You got the seal of God on you right now. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
What we do is we grab a hold of these wonderful elements and we say, this is my redemption. This is my salvation. This is how my sin is dealt with. People who try to deal with sin outside of the blood have fallen from grace. They have turned away from God. This is what God has said. And they have sought another way of reconciliation. They've sought another way of being justified and being made right, but we are justified through the blood. We are loose from our sins by the blood. A whole life, independency, and walk in God, and confidence in God, and access to God, and boldness into His holy realm.
Amen.
By the blood. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the name of Jesus. That's why it's so good. You know, it's kind of like walking around, you know, all day long, just walking around. Prasta karaneya, shulaburanishti, vokineshtipat, havavoshtaterishi. Heavenly manna, eat the bread of life. Jesus said, I'm the bread of life. Hallelujah. You feel like you've done something wrong? Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus, for the blood. Lord, I'm never going to have that thing in my life. I never want to offend you like that ever again. I'm going to tell you right now, God will continually refine it in our lives. There is a consecration that we've been consecrated to, a sanctification that has already taken place. We were sanctified by the blood of Jesus Christ. Sanctified by the Holy Ghost, set apart by God. And what happens is we yield to God. It just suddenly we find a place of just enjoying His presence, of living over in the ecstasy of fellowship, that even the slightest little thing that belongs to the realm of demonic disturbs us deeply. Before it maybe not have even been noticed. But suddenly spend more time with Him. And even the little shadows of darkness are repulsive to you. But all the time, there's this blood of Jesus cleansing me. If I walk in the light as He is in light, then the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses me from all sin. I'm walking in the truth as He's in the truth. I'm walking in the realms of His life as He's in that wonderful life. Fellowship. Tonight I pray in the name of Jesus that you let God settle your case permanently.
Amen.
Tonight I pray that you will take a hold of the gift of salvation and you will not let the sacrifice of Jesus be in vain. You won't somehow make God's salvation difficult or complicated, but something that is a gift that comes to you on the simple basis as it came to the woman at the well. When Jesus said, all you need to do is recognize who I am. Tonight, if you're in doubt about your relationship with the living God, all you have to do is respond as Jesus said to the woman at the well. Don't believe philosophy. Don't believe ideology. Don't believe the opinions of men. It's got to be by the Word of God and the Word of God alone. If you can't quote it, you better learn.
Amen.
Because you don't really know anything that you can't speak. Heard people say, well, I know it. But you know what? When your teacher stood you up in front of the class, if you couldn't say it and you couldn't speak it, if you couldn't describe and tell and communicate what you knew, what happened? Failure. And it's correct and it's right. It's not unjust. You want to do it God's way. He said, recognize who I am. All you have to do tonight is recognize who Jesus is. He is God, the Savior of the world, the one who came to bear our sins away at Calvary's cross, to take our sins in his own body. And that's what this represents tonight. I recognize he took my sins in his own body and he put them to death at Calvary.
Amen.
That through this wonderful gift, as he says to the woman, recognize who I am and I will give you to drink. I will give you the cup of salvation is what he's saying. And the life of God will be in you springing up unto everlasting life.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Tonight, that's what this represents. The sacrifice that God paid. If God spared not his own son but offered him up for the sins of us all. If God allowed his only begotten son, the eternal word who was God and was with God, to suffer such agony, to suffer such pain, to go through such a sacrificial offering, shall he not also by him give us all things freely? Oh yeah, he will. But if you're looking to yourself and it's based upon the merit of how well you've done or how well you haven't done, you have made grace void. You have taken away this wonderful mercy of God. I look to him and I say, thank you, Lord Jesus, that you've done something for me I could never do for myself. You've washed me and cleansed me in your blood and that you're there continually. I mean, it's a beautiful thing, dear people. You know, Father has made a way, the way that it, where if we sin, we don't lose out like Adam did. One sin resulted in him dying and being cut off from God. Father has made a way that this righteousness and this justification can abound unto many offenses. If you don't understand that, spend some time with Romans chapter 5 verses 12 through 21. I'd love to have been able to take you through that tonight, but I just felt I needed to go where I went. Understand that Father has made a way to where that he gives us a space of time to repent and get it right if we're doing it wrong. Just like he said to the seven churches, or the six out of the seven, because he had nothing bad to say or correction to say really to the church of Smyrna. He said to everyone else, the other six churches, I gave you a space of time to repent. You better get it right or I will come fight against you with the sword of my mouth. And does he demand it to be perfect? Does he demand perfect? Demand perfect obedience? Absolutely does. Is there a grace to bring us to perfect obedience?
Yes,
yes there is.
Yes.
Is there a means by which God develops us and works with us and makes our way perfect? The blood, nothing but the blood. What can wash away your sins? What can take a sick and twisted and demonized soul and make it whole again?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Oh, precious is that flow. That makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. There's a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. Sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains. Lose all their guilty stains. Lose all their guilty stains. Tonight, you must understand. Let me hear you play something. Come on, guys, be bold. Tonight, you got to understand something. God wants all of your confidence, all your righteousness, all your acceptance, all your ability, all your worthiness, all your boldness to be in nothing but the blood.
Amen.
Nothing but the blood. If you do not have faith in the blood of Jesus Christ, if all of your confidence, if all of your worthiness, if all of your righteousness, if all of your acceptance is not found only in the blood of Jesus Christ, tonight let God show you, let the revelation of his mercy and his salvation come and reveal to you what he's done for us. This is it. This is why these tokens are here. This is to open up your eyes. It's to give you revelation. He that eats his flesh and drinks his blood hath eternal life. He that eats his flesh and drinks his blood dwells in him and he in them. That's what God says. This is God's provision. He said that sinning, transgressing, rebellious Israel, I have given you the blood to take care of purgating the sins. I have given you the blood upon the altar to remove sin out of the way between you and me. God testified for 1450 years of the power of the blood of the Messiah to loose us from our sins, to break off the strongholds of the demonic, to bring us into a place where we could have a union and fellowship with God, where he would be pleased to dwell in our midst. And did we hear the cry in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 19? Having boldness therefore, brethren, by the blood of Jesus Christ, to come into the holies of holies through a new and living way, having a true heart in full assurance of the faith, we're able to step in, as it were, through the very veil of his flesh. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, let me just tell you something about Passover tradition. In Passover, as you take the unleavened bread, the face bread, the bread of his presence, the bread that was there typified in the sanctuary, and you would hide it. And it was the hidden bread, the hidden manna, the athikumen. And what you do for the children is everybody has to go like on a hunt, just like children hunt. Unfortunately. Resurrection eggs. They hunt the hidden manna. Jesus said, I will give you the hidden manna to eat. One of the rewards for the overcomer. Do you know how you overcome? By the blood of the Lamb. You know how you deal with sin? By the blood of the Lamb. You know how you deal with offenses? Blood of the Lamb. You know how you deal with unforgiveness? Blood of the Lamb. You know how you deal with all the powers of darkness? Blood of the Lamb. You know how you deal with every temptation? Blood of the Lamb. By his blood, unto him who loved us and loosed us from our sins. Unto him who loved us and loosed us from our sins with his own blood, and has made us priests and kings, and we shall reign with him. How many of you know where that verse of scripture can be found? How many of you know where that verse of scripture, just raise your hand. If you know where the verse of scripture could be found, raise your hand. You need to learn the Bible. You need to come into the meetings. Stay in the meetings, because I'm going to teach you the Word of God. Amen. You need to go home and you need to give yourself to it. You don't have to memorize what's dear to you. You don't have to memorize it. When you live it, you don't have to memorize it. Unto him who loved me and washed me from my sins. The word is actually, the word means to loose, so that's why I use loose. Unto him who loved me and washed me from my sins in his own blood. Grab a hold of the word. Revelation 1:5 is that verse of scripture. And has made me a priest. And has made me a king. Made. I'm God made. I did nothing. I did nothing but say yes. I did nothing but accept. I did nothing but recognize him and say yes. Said to the woman, he said to the woman at the well, he said, well, seeing as you've been married five times and you're living with a man now who is not your husband, then you need to go through the rehabilitation program for people who've been married five times and are that dysfunctional. And then after you do that, you're going to have to be examined a little bit more and to make sure that you are a fit candidate to receive this sacred and unmeasurable and incomprehensible life of the Almighty God. Can you say that? Not even close. Let's do it like He said it. Because if you cannot receive it like He gave it, you can't have it. Hear me. This is about your soul. This is about your eternity. This isn't about who's right and who's wrong. This is about God being right and Him declaring His word, and let's believe it just like He said it. Because it cannot be mixed and it still be a pure fountain. It cannot be altered and it be His word of life. I mean, Paul was so intense about it. He's talking to Israel. He's talking to Christians who just really, really just want to go ahead and, hey, what's the harm in it? Might as well go ahead and just get circumcised too. He says, you've fallen from grace. As soon as you need something else beside the blood of Jesus, you've fallen from grace. One of the things I so respected and admired about the video that was sent out that Vice President Pence did was he began to talk about his experience with the Lord Jesus Christ and his faith in the what Jesus did for him at the cross. I don't care if you're Catholic, I don't care if you Episcopalian, Anglican, it doesn't matter what you are. When you look to the blood of Jesus Christ and you put your trust in what He did for us and that sacrificial offering, that is the place in which you touch the gift of God and receive a mercy of salvation that changes everything. Listen to me. As long as a blind man is unwilling to believe that Christ Jesus is the healer, he will remain blind. As long as a deaf man refuses to believe that Christ Jesus is the healer that would open up his deaf ears, he will remain deaf. As long as he thinks he's got to do something, got to somehow earn it, somehow got to get fit for it, somehow have to go through some whatever, he can never have God's salvation. It's the same way with this wonderful new creation and this wonderful forgiveness and this wonderful mercy, and this wonderful fellowship. We have to believe it just like God said it and then receive it and accept it like as freely as He gave it and say, it's mine, I didn't deserve it. Maybe some respects you see maybe more proofs, as it were, that testify against you. No matter, God will perfect you, because there will be a witness on the inside saying, no, I want to be right with you, God. I want to do it your way. I'm not going to rely on myself. I'm going to look to you. I'm going to give myself to the supply that you have provided for me, the living bread, the word of life. Give myself to the reading of the word. I'm going to give myself to the drinking of the wonderful spiritual water of life that He's given to us in praise and worship, interaction with the Holy Ghost. Tonight, when you receive this offering, discern the body of Christ. Recognize what the blood has done for you. Recognize what this bread means, this broken body. His flesh became, as it were, the veil. Just a little bit happier. His flesh was like a veil, the veil that stood between the holy place and the holies of holies. And when it was broken, it rent the veil. And He says, now gaze at what no one ever had the right to gaze at. Gaze. Gaze. Gaze, gaze upon me. Gaze, come and behold. Peace to those who are near and to those that are far off. Come on in. Come in. The veil rent it to His body. A little happier. Just a little happier. Just give me a little hunt. Little happy, happy songs. Because I'm living in the joy that He gave to me. Living in the price He paid for me. Want everybody on this side, stand up, please. Come. Come on. Come on, guys. Don't be afraid. The prophets come in peace tonight. Fear not. Love you so much. Just rejoice in the body of Jesus. Just rejoice in the body of Jesus. Just rejoice in the body of Jesus. Go ahead, rejoice in the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. Go ahead, rejoice. Go ahead, rejoice. Go ahead, rejoice. Go ahead, rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice. What is this, baby? Huh?
It's of God.
Huh?
She goes, it's of God.
You just work with her some more. Work with her some more, huh? Thank you, Lord Jesus. We love that baby. She thanks us for refreshments. And this sort of. Love you, baby. Rejoice in the body of Jesus. Rejoice in the sacrifice that he made at Calvary. Go ahead, rejoice. Rejoice in the sacrifice he made for you. Hallelujah. Go ahead, rejoice. Go ahead, rejoice in the sacrifice. Hallelujah. Ah, the body and the blood. Tambrosare. No need to be concerned anymore or worried. Feel like somehow you're not a part of the family. Somehow you're not worthy. Here's all my righteousness.
All my righteousness.
Here's all your worthiness. Go ahead, rejoice in the body of Jesus. Go ahead, rejoice in the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. Go ahead, rejoice in the body of the Lord. Just Boratasi. Just the Noritist. Rejoice. Rejoice. And again, I say rejoice. Hallelujah. Rejoice. Was the water cold today? Huh? Wasn't bad, huh? Rejoice. The Lord just designed that day for you to get baptized today. Isn't that awesome? Rejoice in the body of Christ Jesus. Rejoice in the body and the blood. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, what else do you need besides the body and the blood? What else do you need besides the body and the blood? Huh? You don't need anything. All the rest comes a part of the package. Rejoice in the body and the blood. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." This is that wonderful work of grace that we see there when he bore in his body our sins, where he was broken, where his body was flogged with the stripes so that you and I could live. Hallelujah. Go ahead, rejoice in the body of the Lord. Go ahead, rejoice in the body of the Lord Jesus. Go ahead, rejoice in the body of the Lord. Go ahead, rejoice in the body of the Lord Jesus. Go ahead. Go ahead, rejoice. Go ahead, rejoice. Is that what you look like when you rejoice? Go ahead, rejoice. Go ahead, rejoice. Rejoice. This section comes thin. Rejoice in the body and the blood of the Lord Jesus. Come on. And come on, sing a song that, or do a song that I can recognize. It's not just float around here. Rejoice in, we're floating around. Rejoice in the body and the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, now I the found I know nothing but the blood of Jesus. Rejoice, 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 rejoice. And again I say rejoice, rejoice, rejoice. And again I say rejoice, rejoice, rejoice. And again I say rejoice. Mamanga de devre bebete da mandala si frekis de brambra bebetest. Halle mambra betandala ma kuramba vos sister in evri. Melistere be mandala ma kekvrasta. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. What hymns do you know? Sing a hymn. Sing a hymn unto him. Hallelujah. Sing a hymn.
There is room at the cross for you. There is room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. There's room at the cross for you.
Sing another hymn.
I get so thrilled with Jesus every moment of the day.
Rejoice.
I get so thrilled
Rejoice.
With Jesus. He's the
Rejoice.
Truth, the right
Rejoice.
Way.
Yep,
I get
take
so
it.
Thrilled with Jesus.
Rejoice.
He satisfies my longing soul.
Rejoice.
I get so thrilled
Rejoice.
With Jesus. He's the one who made me whole. I get so thrilled with Jesus every moment of the day.
Thank you, Jesus.
I get so thrilled with Jesus. He's the truth, the life,
yes, you
the
did.
Way. I get so thrilled with Jesus. Satisfies my longing soul.
Go ahead, grab
I get so
it.
Thrilled
Gotta take it.
With Jesus. He's the one who made me whole.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Sing another hymn. Sing another one.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise. Just to know, thus saith the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Come, girls. Come. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Just keep playing that. Just, you can just instrumentally it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, living God. Lord, we worship you. We thank you for your precious blood that has washed away and cleansed us from all of our sin. Dear people, will you take the communion tonight? Will you begin to just drink of the cup? What you do is you recognize that your sins have been all washed away. If you don't believe that your sins are washed away, you have no right to drink the cup. But I can remedy that real easy. All you have to do is say, Lord Jesus, wash away my sins in your blood. And they washed away, if you simply believe. Amen. And that tonight, you'd move forward, not being burdened, heavy laden with sin, for as long as it's there, we'll have power over you. But now sin shall have no more dominion over you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. The Jews said to Jesus, said, if you're the one, give us a sign. Moses gave us manna to eat in the wilderness. What miracle will you do? He said, Moses didn't give you the true bread
said, I am the true bread. I am the bread of life. Tonight we just thank Father so much. He's amazing that he gave us the children's bread, the true bread. Listen, a bread that represents the Lamb, a bread that represents, that means by which Israel partook of fellowship with God that evening at Passover. And it resulted in the next morning there was not one sick or feeble one among them. The bread that represents his broken body, describing the one whose stripes you and I were healed. Go ahead and be healed right now. Got sickness in your body? Go ahead and be healed. Go ahead, start recognizing, my goodness, this is food. This is meat indeed. Hallelujah. This is life. I can spend my whole day just living off of what Jesus has supplied for me through his body. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. No, just stay with a song that I can recognize. Stay with a song that we can recognize. I know you're having communion, but you gotta do this. Ministers of the house do this and are blameless. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. And I look across this room tonight and I see people, women and men of God, who are under the divine order of heaven. They're not doing their own thing, they're doing God's thing. It's amazing. Living by the very body of Jesus, living by the very life and being of Jesus. I mean, just that bread, it's just representative that we took Christ Jesus on the inside. He's living on the inside. We're living by him. When you've been fasting for a long time, you eat bread, all of a sudden you get strength. Before you couldn't do anything, now you're all up and running around. Why? You were supplied strength. You were supplied life by the bread you ate. This is the kind of spiritual life and divine ability that God has given to us, through our being willing to trust in him, have faith in what Jesus did. Our looking to him, our abiding in him, our dwelling in him, our relying upon him, the recognition that we can do nothing of ourselves. Immediately, you turn to Jesus, Lord, strengthen me. He strengthens you, just like eating the bread. When you've been fasting, you feel it more then. But eating the bread, even when you haven't been fasting, gives you strength, gives you the ability to move on, go on. To think right, to function right. Start living this way. Spend more time with the communion. What does communion mean? Fellowship. This is the fellowship. It's how we interact with him. It's based upon his body. He bore my sins in his own body. It's based upon his body. It's based upon his life that he gave to me, represented by the bread where I eat that, and the lamb, you know, as it were, is now on the inside of me, strengthening me, and I'm living by it. Hallelujah. His life is meat indeed. And after that they supped, he took the cup and he said, this is the new covenant in my blood. Don't believe in any other covenant except for the way that Jesus put it. He said, this is the new covenant in my blood, which is given to you to erase, remit, do away with all sin. So he says, your sin and your iniquities will I remember no more. And I have absolute confidence that I'm sinless. Amen. That I have no stain of sin. Because how can you trust that the blood of Jesus would wash away your sins, and yet after you said that, say, oh no, I still have sin? That doesn't make any sense on any level. This is the new covenant in His blood. He did it for us. The Lord looked and He wondered that there was no intercessor, that there was no one who understood. So He said, by My own power and by My own arm will I bring salvation. Thank You, Lord Jesus, for the precious blood that has washed away our sins, that has brought this life, Your life, into us. You know, it's really good for you to just repeat with me what I'm saying. It's really good. It's good to do the same thing when we can do the same thing. And there's sometimes we just cut you loose and say, just go ahead and sing in the Spirit, pray in the Spirit, worship God. But sometimes you just want to be mindful of what's going on around you. You want to really be hooked in. We just say it together, you know. Lord Jesus, thank You for Your precious blood.
Thank You for Your precious blood.
Your blood that has washed away my sin. Your blood that has brought Your life into me.
Your blood that has brought Your life into me.
Jesus. Thank You, Lord Jesus. Thank You, Lord Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, mighty God. Oh, mighty God. You should not have one moment of shame. And if you fall into some kind of thing, the enemy trips you up, tricks you, just immediately take the blood and be fully restored. And to go through some crisis management, some recovery program, because that's trusting once again in human, the arm of flesh and human effort. All my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Lord, we love You. Hallelujah. Sweet, delicious, good. No sour there. No leaven there. No bitter there. It's good. Refreshing. There's life in it. You know, after I've lived in His presence for 10 billion years, in my resurrected body, and I begin to discover all the things about who He is, and my being shines with the same glory that He has, still I will say nothing but the blood of Jesus. Still I will come and celebrate and sing unto Him. Unto Him who loved me and washed me from my sins in His own blood. Still, all my righteousness will be His blood. All my worthiness. All my right to approach unto the Father. All my right to know that God hears me and answers me and works on my behalf. Blood. All my acceptance, all my confidence, all my assurance, my full heart. True heart of assurance. The blood. There is a fountain drawn from Emmanuel's veins. Sinners plunge beneath its flow, lose all their guilty stains. Tonight, can you just bask in, receive the acceptance, the union? Fellowship, the oneness, supplied to us through such an amazing act of divine grace. This blood purchased me. I'm bought with a price. I'm not my own. I was purchased by the blood. For we were not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver and gold, but by the precious blood of Jesus, as a lamb without spot or with blemish. I'm owned by God because of the price that He paid. And that purchase price He paid is His blood. He sought me out. He called me. He ordained me through the work of divine grace. The price of my salvation, the power that would break the strongholds of sin and iniquity and the claim of Satan of death, His blood poured out, His life given. Not by some easy way, some means less than sacrifice, and it wasn't even the quick slaughter death of the lamb at the altar. But the beating and the stripes and the crown of thorns upon His head. The nails pierced hands and feet. And a spear pierced through His side. It would cause the blood to flow. Redemption's price. How God so loved me, rescued me. I should look to nothing other than Him, nor trust in anything else. It's all in that which God did when He gave His body and His blood. When as a sacrifice and as a lamb slaughtered upon the altar of God, there on Mount Moriah, where Abraham offered Isaac and the Lord provided for Himself a lamb, there on Mount Moriah, in Bethel, the house of God, where Jacob saw by revelation, we dwell in the house of the Lord and knew it not. Where a covenant is established, where the temple was built, where the altar, the stones were ordained and consecrated and the oil poured out, and God said, I am the God of Bethel, El of Bethel. And now identified His own name with an altar built by His servant. A place to meet with man. A place where the blood was offered. Sacrifice was given. The temple built. The evening and the morning sacrifice established. That one day would be the site of a Roman cross. Where God, the eternal Word, made flesh. Born to die. Should we trust in anything else? Should we look to any other power to remedy our problems, our issues, to solve those things that are impossible to fix? Nothing but the blood. my strength, my life, my power. Is there any power greater than this blood, which is eternal in the heavens and forever lives? Every drop was collected by the angels of the Lord and taken into the holies of the holies and exists there today. And we show forth his death. And in his death, we describe that we died too. And in his resurrection, we identify that we now live in him. You are my righteousness. You are my sanctification. You are my life and worthiness. Only in you, O God. Only by you am I acceptable. Have a problem tomorrow, an issue, crisis, take a sip of communion. Feel uncertain, worried, confused, distant from God, take another sip of the price that purchased you. Feel weak, tired, weary, go ahead and eat the heavenly manna. Eat the bread of life. Be strengthened by the body of the Lord in this fellowship and communion of his life he gave for us. Just receive it. Live it. Enjoy it. Celebrate it. Rejoice. Everybody stand. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I put a blessing on every person in this place. I speak life and peace to you. Everybody who's a part of this ministry and is under authority, we want you to come and press in with us this Wednesday night, this Thursday night, this Friday night. We want you to spend the next couple of days just preparing your heart to seek the Lord. We don't want you to be offline doing your own thing. We want you to stay over here in this communion, in this fellowship, because this is oneness. The bread and the blood speaks of our oneness with him. His life is in us. We live by him. Hallelujah. He exists in him. And in this communion fellowship, just prepare your heart, because we're just believing God for a great outpouring. We're believing God for a great moving of the Spirit in you, in your life. Not somebody else, in you. Here. Because that will result in great things in the city when you start living that much more into a greater display of the life and glory of the person of Jesus. The elements of his life, sipping on it. The elements of his life, chewing, swallowing, as it were, his being. Redemption symbol, redemption's life, redemption song. Don't miss out. Don't have excuses. Come. Press in. Come with a full heart of joy and rejoicing. Come with praise and shouts of praise. Hallelujah. Come with joy and rejoicing. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Hallelujah. Go ahead and tomorrow just be mindful. Let the Holy Ghost remind you. And all through the day, go ahead in the fellowship, be continually filled with the Spirit. And if you don't know how to be filled with the Spirit, take a sip of communion. Take another bite of the body. There you'll find great confidence and boldness, and say, fill me, Holy Ghost. Fill me, living God. Fill me now. Just let your hands be filled right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Just go ahead and be filled. Just go ahead, be filled. Go ahead, be filled. Go ahead, be filled. Go ahead, be filled. Speak to yourself in psalms, the hymn, spiritual song. Go ahead. Let clothing tongues of fire come rest upon every one of your head. Let the rushing mighty wind of the Spirit of the living God blow through you. Let the rivers of God flow through you. Let the power of God overwhelm you. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's it. That's it. Just go ahead and dance around a little bit. Rejoice. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God.
What miracles, what great miracles. Oh. Oh. What great miracles. What a great miracle. The life of God come into me. What great miracles. The life of God dwelling now in me. What great miracles. The glory of His presence and His power to set every soul free. What a great miracle. All our life in God, God's life in us. What a great miracle to be bought with the blood and life of the eternal Word. What a miracle where sin and death has no power, where the grave has no hold. What a miracle. And I want you to know that you can equally go ahead and shout and prophesy just as I did. At any time, it's never a disruption. It's never a disruption. Just lay hold on eternal life. Lay hold on what God has for you. Don't back up. Don't do it your own way. Don't follow people that never had much of anything going on in their life anyways. Why would you follow people who've never really had much of a demonstration of the Holy Ghost in power, act like them, dress like them, walk like them, talk like them, be like them, sing like them? Now, come on. Go after Pentecost. Go after the celebration. Where when you stumble out into the street, you look like a bunch of people who've been drunk. Been drinking wine, intoxicating wine, and you have to say, no, we're not drunk as you suppose. seeing, but it's about 9 o'clock in the morning. But this was that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. I have purposed to live in that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, the messianic age, that it should come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh.
The action of it, the glory of it, the joy of it, the rejoicing of it, the celebration of it, the continually being filled by it, the fire and the glory of His presence,
the visions, the dreams, the prophecies, the ecstasy of it, the life of it, the fellowship of it, the glory of it. What a miracle. Marato si kirina mast. Go right up into heaven right now. 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 Into heaven right now. Come right up into heaven right now, says the Lord.
Listen to me. Just spend time in His presence. And Father will give you the ability to respond to His invitation. Because He'll fill you with things that are not your own creation. There's not something that came, as it were, from the resources of your own human being. It's that which He fills us with from heaven. Oh, He's here so gloriously. Oh, He's here so powerfully. Oh, all that you have need of is right here, right now, available for you. Healing for your body, strength for your soul, enlargement for your heart so you know how to move with the Holy Ghost. He's here. He's here. Whether you can recognize him or not, it doesn't matter. He's here. He's here. And though you stand here, maybe you're completely unaware, you're oblivious, you feel nothing, God in his mercy has given you ability to begin to sense him now. So that in the future you might be able to respond to his invitation when he literally asks you to come up into heaven now. God prepares our hearts to be able to respond to his invitation, to receive from him, to move with him. Don't miss out. Just hunger. Oh, so good. So divine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Katariba. Woo. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, God is so good. I want you to get ready now and worship the Spirit of the Lord. Worship the Lord Jesus. Worship the Father and bring an offering, something very important to you, something that costs you, something that, listen, don't just always be doing the same thing with God. Be allowing the Spirit of the Lord to enlarge your faith and increase your faith. And I mean, if you spent, you know, the past year giving the same amount in the offering, don't let yourself stay there. Say, no, we're going to grow. Talk to yourself. Give yourself a little talking to. Say, you, we're going to grow. And we're going to develop in faith. And we're not going to stay where we're at. And our finances is an indication of us staying one in one little area. To walk with God and be used by God, you have to learn to be very generous. If you don't learn to be generous, what you're going to be is selfish. And you're going to, it's going to be about you, and it's going to be too much stuff that is going on in your life that is a response to your own need. And Father does this in a very special way. He helps us to learn how to be generous. He teaches us how to be givers. And you show me someone who gives lavishly, and I will show you someone who already was a worshiper who worshiped lavishly. Y'all learn how to worship God excessively. Give things lavishly. Otherwise, you're just, listen, you can say it's not about money, but I'm going to tell you right now, God has said it is. The Lord says it is. It is about money because it's the treasure of your heart. That is absolutely important to him. Wherever your treasure is, there's where your heart will be also. And there's so much of our trust and our value system that's centered around money. And the majority of it, we do it and spend it all on ourselves. And if that doesn't need a little bit further examination and thoughtfulness by each person, to really look at that for what it is, then I'm certain to tell you, I tell you this, there's nothing that is as much, that is worthy of as much attention as us just looking at that. And here's the beautiful thing. With all that Father has called us to do, you know, when John's talking to Gaius at Gaius' house and he's just saying, you really got it. You're walking in the truth. I rejoice over you and your children walking in the truth. Why? Because they lived. Their whole work was about taking care. Their whole work. They went to a job and they worked to make money to take care of all of God's servants. That's what they did. They lived to take care of God's servants. That's what the church at Macedonia did. The church at Philippi did it. That, I'm telling you, has become a very important central part of the New Testament. And God, in His mercy, has been willing to hook up with us in a supply of miraculous provision in a response to what we do. Because you don't work to, you're not ever going to work for God for free. He pays good. He pays good. He pays good. You're never going to seek Him and be disappointed or left out. He's not leaving you in some kind of poverty and lack. And He's told us to take care of the orphans, to take care of the widows, to take care of traveling ministry, to take care of the poor brethren, and to take care of the needs of the household of the church. You, your responsibility, my responsibility. And so He's purposed to miraculously supply the ability for us to do that, because He never asks us to do something that He doesn't give us the power to do it. But it's always going to be a step of faith. It's always going to be a place where we cooperate with God for the miracle. And if we don't cooperate with God for the miracle will not happen. I don't care how desperate you are to receive it. We already know how desperate God is for us to have it. There has to be a connection. There has to be a participation. You have to cooperate. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Ann and I, we were just in some meetings, and the Lord just laid on our heart. We were with Pat, and I said to Pat, the Lord wants you to give more generously. And as soon as I said that, the Lord told me, He said, show Him how. So we gave a lot of finances. Basically, we always emptied out the finances. But you know what I found? As we emptied out, Papa fills it up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He does it. Because we, with total abandonment, we take no thought for our own life. We don't calculate anything. We just, what do we have? Just give it. Don't even think about it. And when we do that, we total abandonment, the Lord always provides super abundantly. It's amazing. It's just amazing. And no, it is miraculous. And it's not how you think. It is miraculous. God does it miraculous. So He is. And so we've given all this, just, and then it's one thing after another, wasn't it? One thing after another. I can't tell you how many things broke down. Well, hey, we get an airplane that's broke down. We're sitting in the airplane for 3 hours. Like next airplane broke down. We get in our car. We drive like 25 miles. It breaks down. It's what, 12:30, 1 o'clock in the morning? I never had that happen to me. You know what I did? I took no thought of it. You know what some people will do? They'll take that thought of it and they'll start putting dots together that have no connection. And it is not a pretty picture. We just stood back and watched God do some amazing miracles. Just, you don't understand, you don't know. I want you to understand, I want you to know. I want you to be used by God to go beyond anything that you would ever be able to produce out of your own human effort and ability, not just in the areas of finances. That's just one small area, because it's all the same way. If you're trying to look to what you can do and your provision and how you can calculate it, you could never have it. You will look to trying to provide your own discipline and places of surrender to God and the empowerment that He gives. You'll try to find, you'll always look to yourself, you'll be disappointed in yourself, you'll be overwhelmed by yourself, because you always look to yourself because you're stuck in the self realm. But when you begin to be generous, you begin to trust God for supernatural provision, then when the Lord says something that strikes you and you recognize that you need that, immediately go, thank you, Father, that is mine. I receive that now. Because see, you hear His voice telling you what He's going to give you. Instead of hearing His voice telling you that you got a problem and now you feel inferior and left out. No, no, no. You hear His voice telling you what He wants to give you. You start hearing differently. You don't hear where you feel failed. You hear where God wants to supply so you succeed. It's a different way of thinking. It's a different way of living. It's a different, and what makes a difference is whether you're selfish or generous. Whether you're looking to yourself to supply what you need, or whether you trust God to do it. And it must be at every level to be at any level. It must be in every dimension of your life to be in any dimension of your life. If it's not here, then it's not there. If it's not in your money, then it's not in your spirit. You can never move in the realms of faith that God wants you to move in. And we got great things to do. God wants us to do great things. I believe with all of my heart. Listen, listen. Do you know what I'm going to do? Can I tell you what I'm going to do?
Yes.
And let me know what's going to happen. I'm going to wake up in the morning one of these days in the very near future, and the power and the glory of God will so rest upon me that everything I say will happen. That the extraordinary miracles and the signs and wonders will have not been seen since the days of Jesus.
Amen.
That's what I'm doing. That's what's going on with my life. That's the whole dimension of everything. Whew. Whew. You think I'm living my own life, or I have any desire to live my own life? I cut that thing a number of years ago. I stepped over from it. How valuable is it? How much does one drop of His blood cost? $10 trillion? One drop. Not all of the riches in the universe can pay for one drop of His blood. And He gave it to me. Riches of heaven. When you start reckoning with God and what He's supplied to us, it's a whole new disposition of seeing, thinking, and receiving. I want you to have it. I want you to have it. Father wants you to have these things. Some of you, you just have to begin. You never, just understand this. You don't appear before God with something that's common and ordinary. Don't tip God. It's not, it's something that is already developed in you. It's the precious things. It's you bringing your precious things to God. One day I discovered that my wife was giving away every precious thing I ever gave to her. She's giving it to the Lord. I said, baby, I want you to hold on to some of that. She's like, no. I want to give it. I can't get in the way of that. Because Father's going to give her more precious things. Start giving your precious. Don't tip God. Never appear before Him empty-handed. You come and you worship Him with that which costs you. Not that which is convenient. Not with that which you can live without. But that which costs you. That which is a price for you. Just always do it. Say, well, I did it last week with the evangelist Tim Hall. Good. Well, we were able to give, you know, Tim like $6,600, something like that. We gave it all, 47 cents, I can remember. 66, 36, 47 or something like that. He's like, no, praise God. And everybody that was part of that, you have fruit abounding to your account. God's teaching you how to move in faith so it can be multiplied to you. Amen. Keep with it. Don't weary in well-doing. Amen. Just worship the Lord tonight. Find a bunch of people. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Say, it's real sacred in the house right now. God's in the house. And it's real sacred in the house right now. God's in the house. And it's real sacred. The presence of the living God is here. The power of the Almighty is working. The power of the Almighty is working. If you're sick, be healed. If you're weary, be refreshed. If you're weak, be made strong. If you're in pain, I command the pain go out of your body now. If you're in need, God will supply your need according to His riches and glory. You know what? There are some of you who give so much of your finances you don't even have food to put on your table. And I want you to know something. God sees it. And I promise you, I know what happens when you do that. I know what happens. You watch. You'll find out that God really is God. You discover how big He is, I promise you. Thank you, Jesus. Well, praise the Lord. Listen, find a bunch of people around you. Hug them, tell them you love them, bless them in Jesus' name. If anybody wants prayer for anything, come and pray with you. Spirit of the Lord is here. It's real sacred in the house right now. God's in the house. Almighty God's in the house. Almighty God is in the house. The Lord of hosts. I am that I am is in the house. He who is from everlasting to everlasting is here. The Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, He's here. El Shaddai, El Elyon, El Roi, God who sees me. Yehovah Yira, God my provider. He's in the house. He's here. The Lord who healeth me. Yehovah Rophe. Hallelujah. The eternal word. is God the Father's present, wrapped up into flesh and given to you and me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Lord, I thank you so much for great signs and wonders in Quebec City tonight.
Yes.
Father, I thank you for your great exploits and your great miracles, Father. That you establish and have a life, because all we want is you. All we desire are the things that you're doing. Hallelujah. What do you need?
Huh? We got staples after the baptism.
At the
baptism? Yeah.
After the baptism?
Yeah, yeah, going to the car, he ran into the lifeguard tower and turned around the ladder.
Kasmack?
So his head's really sore, so he wanted prayer.
Lord Jesus, we ask you to touch Jude right now. In the name that is above all names, the wonderful name of Jesus, we thank you for healing this head. We know ill effects of it in Jesus' name. Touch the house of the knee cases. Jesus. What do you need?
Just to know God, to really know God.
Oh, amen. He just keeps seeking after you. You know him, and you'll know him more. You'll know him more. He's laid hold on you. Your life is so radically changed. And Father's going to give you such boldness and confidence and such certainty. I promise you. I promise you. Great boldness in the faith. Great confidence in Jesus' name. A divine manner and a divine ability simply is not earthly and not of men. What do you want? What do you believe you can have? Do you believe you can have that? What kind of strength do you want?
Oh, I said to drink. Move yourself. Move your body.
Drink?
Yes.
Where a river flows?
Yes.
Can you believe you can have that?
Yes.
Well, go ahead and take a drink then. Drink. Drink. Jesus, restart. Drink. Just drink. Just drink. Thank you, Jesus, the right out of this belly. There's the glory of heaven. Thank you, Jesus. Father loves you so much. Don't doubt it. They've done it. He loves us even when we don't know how to receive it, don't know how to flow in it. He loves us desperately. Wonderful. What do you want? Annalyn of the Most High God. Annalyn of the Spirit. You mighty woman of valor. You servant of the Most High. What would you like God to do tonight? Great signs and wonders, exploits of God through your life, being strengthened and prepared with divine ability. Where your emotions become as an instrument that he plays. Your passions, that which he expresses his glory through. Your affections is a divine light shining in a dark place. For all your deeds are wrought in God. And all your actions, the movements of the Spirit, the living God. What do you want? Here, stand away from the speaker so I don't pierce your ear with feedback. What do you want? Father, we thank you that you teach your servant Brad how to lose his life. You know, we had this initial consecration event. I've lost my life. I surrender my life, Lord. And then through our relationship with him and our walk with him, he shows us how. He shows us how to do it. It's a consecration and commitment, and he shows us how to do it. And every time we respond, the brightness of his glory is revealed in us. Splendor of heaven. Splendor of heaven. You can go to bed and you lay down at night with great confidence. Father, you know how desperate I am for you. To know you, to be used by you, God, for you to take hold upon me. So that I know how to do what you commissioned and purposed me to do. Visit me tonight. Visit me tonight. Visit me tonight. Visit me tonight. You don't take too many nights of that. Sometimes people just say it once and they forget about it. No, I pray in the name of Jesus. These things burn in your spirit and burn in your mind. You can't forget them because it's such an explosive desire, a passion. You can't forget it anymore. You can forget eating breakfast. Or your necessary food, as the psalmist said. That necessary food is the food that you need to eat because you're real hungry and you're feeling weak. Sometimes we get to really working hard and I forget to eat. And all of a sudden I start staggering around, getting a bit weak and a little lightheaded, like I remember. Right? Because that's the necessary food, right? And I'm looking around for Ann. Pastor Ann, where's she? That's her department. Hallelujah. She does a great job. Oh. You know, we have got the makings and the developments right now because of particular things that are happening in Oregon. God setting up and organizing a great move of His Spirit where this building, when we finally get it up in a very short time, be filled on the night services. Filled.
Amen.
Filled. There are many things in Southern California and in San Diego that would hinder the flow and the moving of the Spirit of the Lord, that would affect and afflict the people of God and keep them from being able to move forward with the Lord and cooperate with Him. God's people in this area have to learn how not to be influenced by those things that dominate this place. Because when we're no longer influenced by it or overcome by it, suddenly we have authority over it. And what Father is doing in other places, He'll just do here, even in a great way. I mean, just do it here. Just do it here. He's purposed to do some wonderful things here. You have to lay hold on it. You have to lay hold. Tomorrow you got to practice telling yourself how you feel. Tomorrow you've got to give yourself to being filled with the Spirit of the Lord so you can tell yourself how you feel. When you're filled, there's no problem to tell yourself how you feel. To be filled, to have the right feel, links. What do you want? Huh? Well, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, your flu and sickness and virus, I command it to go out of your body now in Jesus' name, and you obey what I say. Amen. I love you so much, baby. Healed. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. What a blessing, darling. Thank you, Jesus. My, I just love the presence of the Lord. All this in heaven too. Yes. Shoot. Oh, hallelujah. Joy unspeakable, fullness of joy.
Yes. Phew.
Ha. Life forevermore. Experiencing the very life of God is quite an experience.
Yes.
It's quite an overwhelming interaction with the Lord. What do you want? What do you want that you believe you can have? What more would you like to receive? How much more do you believe you can have? It's got to be within the realm of what you believe you can have right now. What would you like? Is it a category of peace? Category of love? Category of confidence? Category of faith, of joy? There's all kinds of things in the list of categories. The menu is big. Lots of items to choose from. Many flavors. Hallelujah. You can have a side dish or a main course. Stand up. Let me tell you what you need. You need to respond to the faith that God has given you, which is a dedication to only listen to and believe and cooperate with His Word and refuse all other influences. Father's left it within the power of your will. No one else can interfere. And I'm going to tell you right now, listen to me. I promise you, God sees what's going on in your life. He sees your dedication. He sees your consecration. He sees your abandonment in every area of your life. And He's going to reward you, Mr. Jason Cole. Saint Jason Cole. Faith just increases in you. The gift of faith, the working of faith, the moving of faith. Spirit of the Lord. Spirit of the Most High. Gives us insight and ability that we cannot have unless the grace of God impart it. Imparts it now. And gives it now. Today is the day. Today is the acceptable time. Now. Now, God. Now, God. Now, God. Now I command you to be blessed, and you step out in faith and you just lay hold on the better thing. I said you step out in faith and you lay hold on the better thing. And don't you worry about how you're going to pay for it or take care of it. You lay hold on the better thing. You watch what God, it's God's provision. It's God's open door. Don't hesitate. Amen.
Amen.
You lay hold on the better thing. Sit around and ask the Lord, should I have that? Do we really need that? He opened the door. Don't hesitate. Don't hesitate. Don't hesitate. Right now in the name of Jesus. The Lord says, walk in my word. Obey what I've said. And you will have peace as a river. And your righteousness will be like the mighty waves. And you shall enjoy days of heaven upon the earth. And that which God gives you and your offspring will be blessed and will rejoice and will delight itself in the things of the Spirit of God and find their place in the kingdom throughout the ages to come. This is what the Lord says. So be excited about these promises, about these things which God will faithfully bring to pass, and those who refuse to live without Him. Hallelujah. Now just be strengthened on the inside. Just be strengthened. Just be strengthened. Jesus Roboshi up a fatilo. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Father. It truly is joy divine. You know, when the Lord says rejoice, just begin to do it. And as you will, it will multiply. As you just simply obey the word of God, it may be nothing but a little ha. Maybe nothing but a little smile. Thank you, Lord. But if you just stay with it, it will get stronger. He'll supply that which He's commanded you and I to have. When He calls you up into heaven, start jumping. Start leaping and grabbing. Start going up. Start saying, yes, oh God, that's what I want. Do it now, Lord. I want that now. Oh, you respond to God. My, the things that happen. Things that took a tokoristiki than I'm about to see. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father, for your healing power, your redeeming power. Ah, The working of your mighty spirit. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, deep within your soul and your spirit, God is at work in you. He is. I know it seems impossible, unimaginable, unbelievable, but He is. Let me see, Mr. Z. What a video you did this morning. What a movie. What a movie. Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Testify of the good things of heaven through Mr. Ezekiel's life, Ezekiel James. Amen. Testify of the good things that you have given and that you have granted those who will believe and receive from you. Yes. Testify of your mighty power and the gifts that you've given unto men through his little life. May his tongue sing of your loving kindness, and may his lips speak of the knowledge, O God, that only you possess. Make known your wonders, God, to the nations of the earth. Thank you, Jesus. Little teeny hands that are going to be big one day. Touch many lives in Jesus' name. Praise the name of the Lord. The atmosphere is charged with this prophecy, with this revelation, with this knowledge, with his gifts. All you need to know is just how to move with them. If you weren't with us on Friday night, please, listen to the YouTube. Making the connection with God. It is fundamental to flowing in the gifts of the Spirit. Never try to flow. Function in the gifts of the Spirit. I just make a connection, the gifts flow. And so, just meditate on it. Rewind it, play it again. Amen. And you know, listen, I'll just tell you, those of you, especially those of you who participate on School of Spirit on Friday nights, it is a blessing. We don't get to do many. But what God is doing with it is just amazing to me because of the people. I mean, I just recently got information from Finland. A ministry there recently started listening to School of Spirit, having it in their ministry and their church. And the testimonies of what God is doing is just amazing. It's just amazing to me. And so you come and you're a part of that, and that whole dynamic of me being able to minister to the things of the Spirit of the Lord that is particular to your ability to receive, you know, has a bearing on what's said.
Amen.
You know? So we're not going to get to do it for a while again. Be a month or so. But there's a bunch of them there. I don't know. There's over 30 Schools of the Spirit. Go through them. I promise you, Debbie Rich Rester will be here this week. She took the School of the Spirit and wrote them all out. That's a lot of stop plays. She's inscribed them. When you see people who've been used by God to move mountains by faith and to do things in the Spirit that others haven't done, do what they did. Don't continue to do what you normally do, because what you normally do has resulted in what you normally have. You know what I'm saying? Does that make sense to you? Model people. Model after. Do what people do. Just understand. It's just it's a pursuit of excellence, grabbing hold of it. Hallelujah. Because you know what's bigger than anything else? What's bigger than just the activity of your remembrance in your mind, your thinking through it? God sees it. And he goes, ah, look at that hunger. He is the God who responds to hunger. He is the God who responds to thirsting, which has a display. It's more than just, oh God, I'm really hungry. Well, you just said you're really hungry. But he, you know, and that's fine. He wants to see the actions and the activities of being really hungry.
Yes.
That's what he demands. The Spirit of the living God is moving in this place to produce the kind of fruit that he's purposed to be seen in the earth. Be happy, rejoice that you get to be here.
Amen. Amen.
Press in, lay hold on it, be so thankful.
Yes.
Be immensely glad at the great things that God is doing for you.
Amen.
We love all of you. Amen.
Amen.
Go home tonight, get some rest. Don't worry about the election. God's already got it all under control. Huh? He raises up. God determines who shall rule in the kingdom of men. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Just participate in love. Let love grow. Participate in the activity of the Spirit of God. Let the things of the Spirit grow in your life. Okay? Amen. Shut everything else down. Move with God. Move with God. Move with God. Seize the opportunities. Seize the opportunities of greatness in God.